In continuation of Ilya's topic, we have some pessimistic presentations, but nevertheless, these presentations raise the majority of questions to which we still do not have any answers. Hence, I will tell you about the historic stages of treating pediatric patients over 18 months with the fourth-stage neuroblastoma. Traditional slide, biological and clinical heterogeneity of neuroblastoma, a lot of its epigenetic modifications that allowed at a certain time to create a risk-adapted approach in treatment of neuroblastoma. By using the new options in treating this category of patients, as well as having studied genetic and biological peculiarities, it allowed us to increase survival from 5 to 45% in this group of patients. But if we analyze this group of patients more attentively, we'll see that we include patients of the fourth stage of the disease over 2 years of age into this group, with the survival not exceeding 10%. Patients with the fourth stage but under 18 months, it may have a more favorable course and be more favorable in terms of genetic and biological parameters, and the group of patients with locally advanced stage of the disease that have MINC gene amplification. Thus, we have an illusion of the gain in survival up to 45-50%, though as of today we understand quite well that the survival in the group of patients over 18 months of age with the osteosystematic involvement of bones is not so bright. In the context of this information, our data, the induction block that we have analyzed, these are the patients that received therapy. Historically, we had five groups starting from 1991 up to 2017. The first diagram shows the efficacy of induction depending on the number of the chemotherapy course, and the second diagram shows the degree of debridement of the bone marrow from tumor cells after chemotherapy, depending on the course of chemotherapy. After every chemotherapy, the bone marrow is debrided after the third course, more often after the first and second course, and complete or partial effect is achieved in more than 70% of cases, in all cases of induction, with very minimal percent of mortality.
Our conclusion is we don't have modified chemotherapy only, and it's induction. It's just the induction component. As to consolidation block, two groups of patients administered that treatment between 1996 to 2007. Navy blue graph shows that out of this group, which covered 25 patients, they didn't have the stage of high dose therapy. Total survival was 24%. Is one patient with stage 4 neuroblastoma, less than 1 year, metastatic lesions of bones and bone marrow. It's a better situation with the second graph. Children with high dose of chemotherapy, it's a significant option which brought about elevation in survival of this group. 38 patients are in this group. Total survival was slightly more than 20% under the median observation period, 96 months. But mindful of the leach, and among those patients, there are two children with stage 3, two with stage 4 without metastatic lesions, and metastasis only in lungs and brain, metastatic lesions of bone marrow less than 1.5 years, and one above 18 months metastatic lesions of bones. Another chart shows high dose chemotherapy in children, 14 patients on the legend. I show the stages. A total survival in this group of patients which were administered high dose chemotherapy between 2009 and 2014, total survival was 33%. Medium observation period was 32 months. In this group, four are alive with stage 3 amplified ONMEG, and one patient with stage 4 without metastatic lesions of bones. Based on this data, we made for ourselves conclusions that different chemotherapy, high-dose chemotherapy regimen don't bring a significant difference in survival for patients over 18 months with bone lesions. So we can see that we reached the threshold of those locations of chemotherapy, high-dose therapy, and like the entire world, we have been striving to invite, to invent new approaches to improve the regimen of high-dose chemotherapy based not on our data alone. We studied literature, and currently we are aware of many modifications, epigenetic ones for neuroblastoma. First of all, it's the regulation of microRNA and methylation and hypermethylation of DNA. Those later data are available. They are indicative of the fact that the use of epigenetic demethylating agents in the therapy of neuroblastoma. It modifies the sensitivity to chemotherapeutic and FDG drugs for this tumor. So in 2014, we recruited a group of patients until 2017, and we introduced the methylating agents at the stage of consolidation, 10 patients in the group, 58% total survival observation, median observation 30 months, and regimen with demethylating agents. You can see also in this slide, everything is represented. I think that and the absence of other circumstances that encouraged us to confirm this pilot study on behalf of our clinic to treat patients with neuroblastoma. It's ultra high risk group patients. From clinical standpoint, we identified this group above 18 months and children with metastasis to the bones, children with other metastasis or the fourth stage of disease. They are entitled to this program, but all the data I'm showing, these data were not statistical analysis, it's purely for grade 4, it's stage 4 with bone lesions. Here is tentative schematic for chemotherapy, or schematic of this pilot study. As the basis, it was Children Oncology Group American Protocol. We didn't modify it strongly. We complied with all the criteria of this program. And in the first two courses of chemotherapy on the induction, it was demethylating agents in standard dosages, 75 milligram per square meter, course one, course two, surgical treatment in patients after third course of chemotherapy. It doesn't contradict with the Children Oncology Group program. And then after fifth or sixth course, I'll tell you why one category five, the other one six, we consolidate high-dose chemotherapy with auto transplantation of peripheral stem cells and exclusion and inclusion of demethylating agents, patients which are brought to the stage of consolidation and split into two groups with residual tumor or metastasis, but MPG-positive patients with a small tumor without a full response on MIBG, and those who are MIBG positive, they receive methylation. It's MIBG 131, then high dose therapy, trimethylfulan, and second group of patients, they don't get MIBG therapy but split regimen, and they receive melphalan, dasatinib. As to surgical treatment, we didn't invent anything new here, and it's a common fact around the world. We complied with the strategies of necessary, possible, and reasonable, actually could be radical removal or maximal debulking. We receive material for further genetic studies of tumor after programmed therapy, and we didn't reinvent the wheel with dosages of radiation therapy. In this program, we discarded we digress from loading therapy. It didn't display its efficacy among, apart from immunotherapy, which is not available for us now, unfortunately. But the motivation was different as well, because we are identifying genetic marker related to relapses and further potential targeted impact to the, in this group of patients who will relapse. And preliminary results of this program, the studies currently include 15 patients. mostly boys, as you see, all children were above 18 months. All of them had metastatic lesions of bone marrow of the brain, 5 or 6 courses of induction therapy, 5 those who did require RMBG therapy, actually to comply with the timing, children on IBG therapy. We have the 6 course of induction chemotherapy, sanation of the brain was done not later than 2nd course. Hematological toxicity and other organ toxicities were not over exceeding when we included epigenetic agents. They were not higher than another program, treatments without inclusion of demethylating agents. And presently, 9 children received this stage of consolidation. 3 out of that number are on IMBG therapy. Other remaining 6, it's split regimen of high-dose chemotherapy with autotransplantation of peripheral stem cells. Toxicity did not overexceed. The organ toxicity did not overexceed the toxicity of those children who are not administered demethylating agents. And the recent call, and you can see the bar here, the current status of those patients. Preliminary tentative results in the flowcharts look so good. Total event-free survival in children from the moment of inclusion into the program, it's those 15 children. Their total survival is 86 and 57 event-free. In one patient, children, parents did not want a treatment. The other one, progressive disease. The oldest girl, 9-year-old, with disseminated process, primary resistant course of the disease. 2 children died. 1 died from progression of the disease after the stage of consolidation, but he was receiving high-dose chemotherapy in another medical institution. He was referred to us with progressing disease. And 1 patient, 19 months, who was included, he died from strong progression 2 days after autotransplantation of peripheral stem cells. And 2 children are relapsing, 1 13, the other 10 months after metastasis into bones. Another one, it shows event-free survival. Those children fully completed the program treatment. 1 died from progression of the disease, and 2 patients relapsed, and now they are in the process of therapy. Conclusions are very much akin to what we had been discussing today. It's a big problem of neuroblastoma. I don't think we should do modification and induction. I think we should work upon some new approaches here. We're fully aware that on the one hand, maybe we should intensify the consolidation because this is the sort of undertreatment and for the relapsing. Of course, we should work on controlling residual minimal disease, maybe genetically directing those cells for maturing. Global issues about new approaches and therapy, which remains open yet with increased relapse-free survival in a group of stage 4 with metastasis. Maybe cell cycle should be used mindful of kinetic components. Maybe it could be demethylating agents or something else. Immunotherapy remains under the question mark because it's not available and accessible yet as an option. And at the end of the day, we should win this disease and treat it within specific time horizons with some guarantees, of course. Thank you very much to all of you, and special thanks to the organizing committee and Svetlana Alexandrovna for having been invited to this.